Good morning, Oaks Christian. How are we doing this morning? All right, very good. If you don't know me, my name is Brian Howard, and I'm the high school pastor here at Calvary Community Church. It's good to be with you all this morning. Hey, thanks to that guy over there. Really appreciate it. My assumption is, some of you know me, my assumption is though most of you don't know me. Maybe you've seen me around, but you don't really know me. And so just want to start off this morning by giving you three things that you need to know about me, three things that capture my imagination, my time, my schedule, my energy. The first thing I want to show you, it'll be three pictures, is this picture right here. This is a picture of my church, and the place we're at in this particular place is not here on campus, but a place we go called High School Ministry Summer Camp. And so what we do is we go away for a week. It's this outrageous week of games and worship and messages and really opportunities to meet new friends. It's this remarkable thing. But every time I look at this picture, I'm reminded that the reason I love my church isn't because of a building or a location. I love my church because it's my family. I love my church because I don't love this building. I don't love getting together on Sundays. That's not the thing. I love it because I love the people here. And so ultimately, the one thing that shapes my life and continues to shape my life is the people of God in the church, because they're my family. So the first thing you need to know about me is I'm a person who loves the church, believes in the church, believes God's church is an incredible and spectacular gift that he's given us that we might know him. Second picture I want to show you is this one right here. This is my lovely bride. Thank you. She's beautiful, and I have no idea why she married me. This is my wife, Dani. We've been married about 5 years now, and it's just been a spectacular journey for us. She graduated here at Oaks Christian in 2009. Love her, love doing life with her. This particular picture was in the fall of 2016. We went to Paris, and she decided to get a photographer. So we did a photo shoot under the Eiffel Tower, which was really, really cool. Third and final picture I'll show you. This is the light of my life. How cool is she? She takes after her mother, not me, because she is beautiful. Her name is Grace. So this is my 6-month-old daughter, the light of my life. Love her. Just a little bit about me. And so as we dive into the Word of God this morning, you may be asking yourself this question. Why begin with those three pictures, and how does that connect to the scripture you're going to share this morning? And I have two words on how it connects. Absolutely nothing. It means nothing. I just want to show you that because I love showing off the people I love the most in my life, and now I want to jump into the Word of God so that you might know a little about me and a little of what drives me toward this Word as we jump in this morning. And so here's what we're going to do. Jonah chapter 1 is where we're going to be. We're going to be looking at the story of Jonah. And my guess is, even if you didn't grow up in church, you heard something about Jonah when you were growing up. Like, it's a familiar story. You've heard about it. It's been on your radar, the story of this guy who gets swallowed by a whale. Interesting story. My hope this morning is to open it up for you, that I might encourage your heart and challenge your soul as we consider the Word of God. And so here's how Jonah chapter 1 begins. It says this. It says, "The word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai." So the beginning of the book is that the word of the Lord comes to Jonah. In other words, the book begins in this way, that God speaks to Jonah. God has something to say to Jonah. And here's what you need to know, that every time God speaks in the Bible, there's a purpose behind it. And the purpose behind God speaking in the Bible is that people might know him. The purpose of God's words in the Bible, the purpose of God revealing himself and showing himself to human beings, is that they might know him and have a relationship with him, that they might be in his presence. The entire purpose of the Word of God, how he has revealed himself to us, is that we might know him and fellowship with him and be in his presence forever. Here's how I'd have you consider it this morning. This morning, I'd have you think about it this way, that the word of the Lord is given to us that we might be invited to the table of God. The word of the Lord is given to us that we might have a seat at the table of God. Well, when I invite people over to my home, and my wife and I have people over, we invite them in the front door and we invite them to sit at our table, to break bread with us, to talk with us, to laugh with us, to share stories with us. The entire purpose of having a table is that people might sit together, they might be together. And the truth about the Word of God is this, that God gives us his Word, that God speaks to us, that we might be invited to his table, that we might be invited into his presence and his fellowship. The story of the book of Jonah begins with the word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai, which tells us this is fundamentally a story about how God is calling people to himself, how God is calling people to his table. It continues in this way in verse 2. God is saying this. He says, "Go to the great city of Nineveh and preach against it because its wickedness has come up before me. And so God speaks to Jonah, and then he gives him an assignment, and that's go to the city of Nineveh. Now, if you've studied the Bible or if you've just studied world history, Nineveh is the capital city of the Assyrian Empire. The Assyrian Empire is one of the most wicked and evil societies to exist in the history of the world. Their brutality, their utter depraved moral stance toward the world is unquestioned in world history. It is a disaster. These people are murderers. They are thieves. They are total idolaters. They are people who are wicked beyond belief. These people hated the people of Israel so much that when Jonah hears this, he's hearing him being told to go speak to the worst kinds of people on earth. But here's what I want you to notice. God says, go to that great city of Nineveh and preach against it. Now, you might hear preach against it, and you might think that this is God calling Jonah to go preach to Nineveh so he might judge them. That's what you might hear. You might see, go preach against it, and you think that's because God wants to judge Nineveh. But here's the truth. If God wanted to judge Nineveh, he didn't need Jonah to go do that. God could have just judged the city. God could have just judged these people. See, God doesn't send Jonah to Nineveh to preach against it because he wants to judge them. He sends Jonah to Nineveh because he wants to save them. He wants to rescue them. In other words, the whole purpose of the book of Jonah is that God speaks to Jonah and tells him to go preach to a city that is filled with wickedness, not to judge or condemn them, but to give them a seat at the table, to invite the people of Nineveh, the most wicked people on the entire face of the earth, to have a seat at God's table. So here's what you need to know this morning. I'm not preaching to you today with the hopes of condemning you. I didn't get out of bed this morning and prepare this message and stand up on this stage so that I could preach to you to condemn you. Hear me, I know there's some of you that want nothing to do with Jesus. You want nothing to do with God. You want nothing to do with his word. This whole chapel experience just isn't your thing. You love this school, maybe because of some other things, but the whole Jesus piece isn't for you. And so hear me, maybe you've been the type of person who's just lived this kind of life that is just openly rebellious against the thing of God. And here's the good news I come to you with this morning. I do not come with news to condemn you. I come with news that God has a seat for you at the table. Like maybe you've lived the type of life where you have things you're embarrassed of and ashamed of. Maybe you've walked in some things that you've never actually told anyone about. Some addictions you're walking in, some things you're dealing with, maybe some stuff in your past that you're ashamed of. And the stunning good news of the gospel is that God has a seat for you at his table. He's got a seat for you. He welcomes you to the table. He says, come sit with me. See, maybe you're the type of individual that actually makes fun of Christians. Maybe you're the type of individual that when you're in chapel here and you see Christians raising your hand, you mock them and laugh at them and giggle at them. Maybe you think church is for losers. Maybe you think Christianity is for dummies. Maybe you think as a pastor, I've wasted my entire life. Maybe you're the person in this room who makes fun of Christians. But here's the stunning thing about our God. He invites you to have a seat at the table anyway. He says, I don't care what you've done. I don't care where you've been. I don't care what kind of offense you've caused. You're still welcome to have a seat at the table. The story of Jonah is the story of a God who pursues the worst people on the face of the earth and invites them into a relationship with him. It continues on this way in verse 3. It says, Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. He went down to Joppa, where he found a ship bound for that port. After paying the fare, he went aboard and sailed for Tarshish to flee from the Lord. And so the story is set up this way, that Jonah is standing in Israel, and God says, I need you to go to the Assyrian capital of Nineveh. And instead, he decides to go to Tarshish. If you look at a map, it's the polar opposite. Might as well say that he went away to Timbuktu. He ran as far away as he possibly could from the word of the Lord. Jonah hears the word of the Lord and responds by running away. But I want you to see how the story continues in verse 4. It says, then the Lord sent a great wind on the sea, and such a violent storm arose that the ship threatened to break up. All of the sailors were afraid, and each of them cried out to his own God. They threw the cargo into the sea to lighten the ship. But Jonah had gone below deck, where he lay down and fell into a deep sleep. So one of the things about the book of Jonah, if you start to read it over and over and over again, you'll realize that it's not just a simple story for children. It is a well-crafted story. And here's something you'll notice. In verse 1, God speaks to Jonah. In verse 2, he gives them a command to go to the city of Nineveh. And in verse 3, he says no. It goes on to say in the text that he went down to Joppa, and then he went down to the port, and then he got on the ship and he went down below deck, and then he laid down, and after that he fell into a deep sleep. In other words, the story of Jonah is the story of a man who hears from the Lord and he gets a command in verse 2. And in verse 3, he decides to run away from the Lord. And what subtly starts to happen is he starts to sink lower. Wow. Thank you. Thank you. I'm tempted just to walk off stage now. He sinks lower and lower and lower and lower and lower, and he doesn't even realize what's happening. And I just want you to know my heart. Because I woke up this morning, as I was driving over here, as I was walking onto campus this morning, my heart is for those of you in this room that are sinking lower and lower and lower and lower, and you don't even realize it. Like, I think there's some of you who love Jesus and you're tracking, and that's an amazing and a beautiful thing. I think there's some of you who have just decided that's not for you, and with integrity, you've just said, that's not me. But I think there's probably a good population of you in here who kind of like the whole Jesus thing, and you kind of want to follow Jesus and be the sort of person that God calls you to be. But without realizing it, this school year, you've sunk lower and lower and lower and lower. Well, like at one point you said, I would never do that type of thing. I'd never date that kind of guy. But suddenly you've compromised and sunk lower and lower and lower and lower. Maybe at one point Jesus was the thing you were pursuing with your entire life, but then things got busy and the school year got hectic and you had tests and you had school and you had sports and you had all these things. And without knowing it, you've sunk lower and lower and lower. And the story of Jonah is this warning for us that as we disobey the Lord, as we run away from the command and the word of the Lord to come to the table, without knowing it, we will sink lower and lower and lower until we have the opportunity to wake up. Here's how the story continues. It says in verse 6, the captain went in and got him. How can you sleep? Get up and call on your God. Maybe he'll take notice of us that we might not perish. Then the sailors said to each other, come, let us cast lots to find out who is responsible for this calamity. They cast lots and the lot fell on Jonah. So they asked him, tell us who is responsible for this trouble. What kind of work do you do? Where do you come from? What is your country? From what people are you? He answered, I am a Hebrew and I worship the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land. This terrified them and they asked, what have you done? They knew he was running away from the Lord because he had already told them so. Verse 11 says, the sea was getting rougher and rougher and they asked him, what should we do to make the sea grow calm for us? Verse 12, pick me up and throw me into the sea, he replied, and it will become calm. I know that it is my fault this great storm has come upon you. Again, the story of Jonah begins in verse 1 with God speaking. In verse 2, he gives him a command to go to the city of Nineveh. And in verse 3, he rebels against that command. He turns away from it. In verse 3, he decides, God, I don't want anything to do with you and your commands and your word and your call on my life. And 9 verses later, he says, pick me up, throw me into the sea, and let me die. Again, 9 verses later, he has gotten to a place where he is willing to forfeit his own life, where he is willing to say, it's all over, it's not worth it. I want you to know the stunning thing about our God. The stunning thing about our God is that he gives every single person who has ever lived an invitation to sit at his table. He says, I have a chair for you, I've reserved this for you, this is your seat. Whenever you want to come to the table, whenever you want to be a part of my family, whenever you want to enter into a relationship, you can. This seat is here for you. But here's the crazy thing about our God. He doesn't force any of you to do this. He doesn't force anyone to sit at his table. In fact, he gives you a choice, and that choice is you can sit at his table or you can walk away from the table. This is the stunning thing about our God, that he has given us the agency, the will, the desire to be able to say, God, I'm going to respond to your invitation or walk away. But here's what I need to be abundantly clear on. To walk away from the invitation of God, to sit at his table and be in his presence and walk in his fellowship is not the path toward the fullness of life. It is the path toward destruction. That the Bible is going to promise us, and my experience with every person I pastor, every person I walk with, my experience in my own life, is that the moments that we choose to walk away from the table of the Lord and do things on our own is not the path toward the fullness of joy and the fullness of life. It is the path toward destruction and heartache and misery. I want to just call some of you this morning who have just been walking away, and you know the invitation's there, but you don't want anything to do with it, to know that the path does not lead toward joy. It does not lead toward everlasting happiness. It does not lead toward peace. It ultimately leads towards something different. See, here's how it continues in verse 13. It says, instead, the men did their best to row back to the land, but they could not, for the sea grew even wilder than before. Then they cried out to the Lord, please, Lord, do not let us die for taking this man's life. Do not hold us accountable for killing an innocent man. For you, Lord, have done as you pleased. Then they took Jonah and threw him overboard, and the raging sea grew calm. Then the men greatly feared the Lord and offered sacrifices to the Lord and made vows to him. Here's the thing you need to know about the story. The story begins with God speaking. In other words, God wants people to be in relationship with him. He gives Jonah a mission. Jonah responds to that mission by running the other direction. And we've already seen that God is inviting people into the story, inviting people to the table, but then something unexpected happens on the journey. We encounter these sailors, and earlier it says the sailors are crying out to their own gods, meaning these sailors aren't people who believe in the God of the Bible. They aren't people who believe in Yahweh, the Lord, the God of the Bible. These are not people who are trusting in the Lord. They're trusting in something else. But it also seems to tell us in the text that when the Lord's name gets brought up, they recognize who that is. In other words, these aren't people who are totally unfamiliar with the Lord, like the people in Nineveh, the people in Assyria. These are people who are familiar with the Lord. They've just chosen to do their own thing. And here's the stunning thing about the story. Through Jonah's rebellion and walking away, God invites another people to the table, another group of people to the table. He invites the people who kind of know about him but haven't been walking with him to come back to the table. Let me speak to anyone in this room who calls themselves a Christian, but you've been wandering. Maybe at one time you were on fire for the Lord and now your heart has grown cold. Maybe at one point you were baptized and walking with the Lord and things were good and you were so pumped up about walking with Jesus, but you've just walked away in the last year or so. Let me talk to anyone in this room who feels like they've wandered far from the Lord. The best news I can communicate to you this morning is that Jesus is still saving your seat at the table. He hasn't given it away to someone else. He hasn't given it up because you walked away. You walked away and he's still saving your seat. You walked away and he says, I'm waiting for you to come back to the table. I wonder if there's anyone in this room this morning that needs to hear that you have wandered far from the Lord, but God is still saving your seat at his table. He's still waiting and wooing and desiring and pursuing that you might come back. Here's how the text closes out. It says this in verse 17. It says, now the Lord provided a huge fish to swallow Jonah. And so this is this incredible moment that's very famous where there's this fish that swallows Jonah and there's all this discussion about, is this a fish or is it a whale or what kind of beast is it actually? And hear me, I studied this stuff in college and in grad school. I studied it in the original Hebrew. And here's what I've come to know. It doesn't matter. It doesn't. Because the point isn't the whale. Here's the point of this story. Jonah should have died at the bottom of the ocean. Jonah should have drowned and died horribly. The whale wasn't God's punishment on Jonah, it was God saving Jonah. Jonah should have died, and God sends a whale not to punish him, but to save him, to rescue him. Because here's the stunning thing that you might not know about this story. We talked about the Ninevites, these people in Nineveh who are just horrible, awful human beings who have sinned wickedly. And I said, God has a seat for them at the table. We talked about these pagan sailors who know things about God but have wandered far, and God has a seat for them at the table. But here's the crazy thing about the story of Jonah. The worst sinner in the story of Jonah is not the Ninevites and it's not the sailors, it's Jonah. It's Jonah, the religious person. It's Jonah, the one who talks to God. It's Jonah, the one who has all the right credentials, who's known as a good, right, upstanding, moral, religious person who trusts the Lord. The worst sinner in this story is the believer. And the worst sinner in this story is the believer, because the believer refuses to believe that God might have a seat at the table for anyone except them. Let me speak to you if you're in this room and you're a Christian. I don't mean you identify as a Christian like you went to church one time as a kid or you celebrate Christmas and kind of think maybe you're a Christian. I mean if you love Jesus and walk with him. You're passionately sold out for him. The greatest danger for you and me as Christians is the danger Jonah faced. It is the danger that we would become judgmental, that we would become condescending, that we would become mean and angry, and that we would start excluding people from the table of God. The biggest danger for you and me is that we would start to judge people because they sin differently than we do. The biggest danger for us is that we would begin to become a people who don't allow God's grace to permeate every person in the world. But here's the crazy thing about God's good love. God could have punished Jonah and allowed him to drown at the bottom of the sea, but instead God saves him. He rescues him through this fish and he says, Jonah, there's a seat at the table for you. Christian, who's a little bit judgmental and tends to find yourself judging people who are far from God and sin differently than you, I need you to know that there's a seat at the table for you. I need you to know that you're welcomed into the family of God. I need you to know that you sit at the same table as the sinner and the wanderer. I need you to know that God invites all of us to the same table, that ultimately the unity we have in Christ is not our moral character, it's the fact that we're all invited to the same table by the same Jesus who offered the same sacrifice for your sins and for me. That ultimately every single one of us is invited to this table, not because we're awesome, but because Jesus is. Here's how the story closes, and our band's gonna come back up and we'll close with some songs, but I want you to hear this. It says this, that he's inside the fish, and it says, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. So here's this moment where God saves Jonah, and Jonah could have drowned at the bottom of the ocean, but instead God decides to keep Jonah in this fish. And the thing I always think about when I see things like this in the Bible is God could have easily swallowed Jonah in a fish, spit him back up immediately, and I think Jonah would have been all right. Like in that moment, Jonah's kind of aware that his life was saved, but here's what God chooses to do for Jonah. God chooses to have him sit for 3 days and three nights so that Jonah can deeply consider the mercy and the love and the grace of our God. I think one of the most beautiful gifts God could ever give us is the opportunity to spend time considering who he is and his mercy and his love for us. I think one of the most beautiful gifts God can give us is the opportunity to consider the invitation to have a seat at his table. And here's what I want to plead with every one of you here. For however long you have left here at Oaks Christian, seniors, it's like a month and a half here or a little less, whatever that is. For the rest of you, it's years left. Here's what I'm going to plead with you to consider. That you would spend your remaining time here at Oaks Christian at least hearing and considering and listening to the invitation that you might sit at the table. Because you may feel disqualified, unqualified, or not good enough, and here's the great news of the gospel, you aren't good enough, but through the sacrifice and mercy of Jesus Christ, he invites you anyway. That's the invitation of Jesus, it's the invitation to the story of Jonah, that all of us would be unified around this table that Christ calls us to sit at. My prayer and my hope and my desire for every single one of us, for the religious Christian, for the person who's wandered, for the person who's far from Christ, is that you would receive that invitation with joy and that you would come to the table. Let me pray and we'll close singing a few songs. God, thank you for this morning. God, thanks for your word, the story of Jonah. I pray that even me, that I would respond to your invitation. That I wouldn't see myself as above anyone, that I wouldn't see myself as better, that none of us in this room would see ourselves as anything but sinners who have been invited to the table of Christ. So God, as we celebrate that, as we surround that in unity, God, I just pray that someone in this room might respond to your goodness, your mercy, your grace, that they would come to the table. We pray this in the mighty, strong name of Jesus. And everyone said,